I'm João Meirelles. I'm a first-year PhD student at UFL, and Klaus has been under supervision. And when I was starting my PhD, actually, I was passing through this phase of literature review that maybe all of you passed through. And I was wondering, I was going through papers on urban metabolism studies, and I was wondering how comparable they are. So I started wondering if I can make a database out of this, and then I found online the metabolism of people website, and they were basically doing the same thing. And then I contacted them, and out of this cooperation started. And I think that what we're presenting here today, actually, it's kind of a new approach for the community. So it's really community-based, and it's interactive, and we'll see later. So we are presenting the Global Metabolism Database that we've been trying to build for the last month. And it's launched, it's online, you can all download, you can all participate, you can all collaborate as well. So I'll start with these four figures of cities. I think everybody knows it very well. Cities occupy 3% of world's land surface. They house some 54% of global population. At the same time, they produce 80% of global GDP and consume 75% of natural resources. These are raw information just to make sure that cities are this very important object to study. And to understand better this resource consumption in these cities, a lot of urban metabolism studies emerged, and they are mainly based on the cities, specific case studies. They use different types of methodologies or approach, data source, and then we were wondering, and actually they rely a lot on a big variety of methodologies, aims, and scope. And these data points, they can be scattered, and maybe it's hard to compare them. And that's basically our main question: what have been done globally in terms of urban metabolism studies? And how consistent those methodologies are, how can we compare this figure? And on top of everything, are there general laws behind the metabolism of cities? So how can you predict, if you don't have really data for the whole city, how can you predict, for example, the city grows, what would be the figures in terms of material throughput or material consumption or waste production and all of this? And then we propose two basic data sets. One of them is composed of publications, so it's a urban metabolism publication database. And then we extract the data from this data set, from the publications, to a really database. So an urban metabolism database containing the data itself, the figures. What we aim at is to make urban metabolism data available and easily accessible, so that researchers throughout the world can access it and start to draw conclusions and understand patterns out of this data. And the ultimate goal is always to compare these and come up with a scientific view over these flows and generalizations or comparisons. So the basic process is this one, using a material flow analysis kind of drawing. Authors and researchers would upload publications with some kind of metadata also to the website. Then this will directly to the publication database. Then we internally pass through a kind of a paper evaluation to rank papers by data interest. And these actually have to do with the amount of data or the how old the paper or how new the paper is. And then we extract the data from those papers, either by connecting the author by email or like receiving the CSV or copy and pasting the PDFs by hand to the database, so that to the urban metabolism database. But actually there's also a way of authors uploading directly the data to the second database. So this would be straightforward. And then authors or researchers can download this data afterwards. So it's always open, it's always online and available to everybody. So first of all, we'll present, do we have internet? Because, no.
Yeah.
No internet.
Yeah.
This is online, so then it makes maybe needs.
Allow.
Oh, nice. It's here. Just need to. Okay, so this is a website and it's online, everybody can access it. And then, for example, if you go to publication research, you can go to the publication database, and here you have the publication. So by now we have 427 publications. And you can click like one of those publications, each one of them, and then you have a set of metadata also about this publication, so date, journal, and everything. This already can be done to, for example, comparison analysis or any type of meta discussion. So this publication map also is produced, you know, just to understand what type of publication and where is the spatial distribution of this publication. You can also start to infer where is missing and what type of analysis the field is still missing. And then we extract this data to this database. So by now we have 8,044 case studies. And I need to, this is still working, ongoing working. So we just done some papers actually. And actually the idea is to open this to the community and who wants to contribute to send the data. We're more than open to receive it and then upload it to the data set. We believe that this is a very important asset for the community. We can work together on this. And so by now we have 44 cities, some 420 indicators and that amount. So then here we have the cities, and then you can also click on one of those cities, for example, and have the indicators. And we created this area to the area columns. So we have been trying to make this guide a bit more, or at least to classify it, so then it becomes a bit more comparable. But also, for example, we can go for the indicator group, so we can go directly for types of indicators, you don't need to follow to the cities. There's a filter, so we can like specify some type of more complex query. And you always can download either from here, this is to download the whole data set, but if you want data from one specific city or another, so this is a big one. But at the end of it, you should have a download button, and then you can download the data from the city as CSV. Yeah, so here it is, you can just download it as CSV, and then you can do your own comparisons. And then I'll just show some first. Okay, this was just done. I'll just show some first outcomes of this data. This is a map of the data of the cities that we have already extracted the data to the final database. We have a distribution of cities actually. Okay, sorry. So this is not the updated version, but anyway, you can go for this type of analysis, which cities have more data points, which have less by type of data. This is for by the classifications that we generated, so it's possible to see how the field is being structured here, or how, at least from the sample that we have by now, how much attention has been given for each flow or for each area of the urban metabolism and each type of indicators. Again, this is just a subset of papers, it's a small one by now, so it's just to show how this database can be used. For example, we can go for temporal evolution of indicators and how much you see the Vienna paper there coming from the 1800s. But most of the data is lately, and you can also distribute by type of flow and understand the evolution of this type of thing. And then we just made this this small comparison first one just to play with it a bit. So we got data from Paris to different papers. Then we tried to compare. This is just population. So one of the papers was defining Paris, was studying the urban metabolism of three different subregions of Paris, or subsets or definitions of Paris. And then we're trying to understand which one was related to each one. And here, for example, it's easy to see that what energy and material flows paper, megacities assuming as Paris, the other paper was assuming as Ile-de-France. So it's just this type of comparison that can be done. And then if you go, for example, for waste, those are two, they're not exactly the same variable, but both of them are related to solid waste disposal to landfills. And you can see how different those are. I mean, this is probably due to some type of assumption or boundary conditions or something like this. And by now, this was just to show how different those figures can be. But also, it's possible to find in the future how close they are, and then start to compare those things. So actually, this talk was more an invitation to everybody. We need your help. We need to upload data. We are also, there's the website. There's, this is the, our email. We have a Twitter. We also have a Boost bank. Or I don't know how to call this. We are there on the hall, so you can just pass by, talk with us. We're open, and we are more than willing to talk with everybody. That's it. Thank you.
Questions as well.
Yeah, Benjamin Bernstein at the University of Michigan. I'm just wondering if you are vetting the data at all, or is anyone vetting the data? Is there any quality control?
The quality control actually is given by that the data to be uploaded needs to have a publication on the database before. So then this guarantees that it's a peer review data set or a data process. And as soon as you have the publication, then you can upload the data. So the quality control is just based on the peer review process.
Any more questions?
Thanks so much. This is really interesting. You mentioned that there might be some distinctions between scope and other sorts of things. Could those be added fields in the database to add value?
So yeah, I mean, we've been thinking about this, and for me, it really makes a lot of sense to code the type of scope or the definition of the metabolism study into those fields. But so far, we haven't come up to a understanding of how this can be efficiently done. But for sure, for me, it should be done too.
Yeah, my question is similar. How much
metadata
should be on each data point?
So those are. At each data point, we basically have 9 fields, I guess, 9 columns. So it's the DOI of the paper, the name of the paper, the city, and then it have a tag if it's for the whole city or for it's a sub part of the city. And then we have basically have the data itself, the indicator, and then we're creating this area and sub area, category and subcategory, and then the unit. And then there is an OBS, which is basically everything. So it's 8 or 7 fields or columns for each data point.
Yeah, sure. Do you think to standardize the data so that we can compare one city with the other?
So this is something that we also have been discussing a lot, and what we see right now, but this is also changing, is that the main thing we can do here is just to dump the data out there and let the researchers do the comparisons afterwards, instead of us like putting our hands on the data that is produced by other researchers. And then assuming things that we might be wrong or not. And then we just prefer to dump everything as it is, raw information. And then for the researchers that will use this data set, they can do their own normalizations or classifications or whatever they want.
Nice.
Thank you very much.